What's better than a simple over and under backyard train set? You can sit in the backyard and have a meal and drinks as you watch the train go round the track. But what's up with that old wooden shed? This backyard could use something else. How about a nicely painted background of a lake? Add a couple of boats and a dock. No, scratch that. Painting the entire wall looks much better. That should probably be finished all the way. How about we light the torches and run the trains at night? Now that's cool. Even with a flash. But what can I do about the old wooden shed? Well, take it down, of course. Most of the wood is still usable. In fact, I knew I could probably make something from it. Gone. So what's better than a simple over and under backyard train set? I know, an over and over and over. 3 foot high garden railroad. First, I designed some vents on my computer. Maybe with a dual purpose. A spiral would be good. Now, something a bit sturdier. I'll need quite a few to reach up to 3 feet tall. It turns out only about 70 were actually needed. Ah, a solid final design. That was in May of 2012. I called Bob Petterson, one of my best friends, and suggested I throw all the wood planks in my car and haul it almost an hour away up to his place so he can help me. Bob is not only a great architect, but he has his own wood shop and invited me up on June 6, 2012. After unloading the wood, Bob helped me cut my old shed into half-inch by half-inch strips. We measured and cut, and measured and cut, until we had more than enough pieces to start assembling the vents. Then Bob helped me design the jig, and let me use his nail gun. It took 100 nails just for one of the 36-inch vents. This took 6 days of intensive assembly work, checking them against my original design to make the vents the correct height and in pairs. One set to go up to 3 feet, and the other set to come back down. Tested the half-inch height differences to make sure the trestles would be level. We put together a temporary support system. That worked well. After 6 days of cutting and nailing, it was time to haul the new vents back down to my place. Once there, I did a test fit in the backyard. I came to realize the vents had to be spaced at least 2 feet apart to not go over a 3-degree slope. 2 months later in August, I started painting. And painting. And painting. And painting. Sprayer would have been quicker. I allowed time for drying and then painted a second coat. Finally, the brown coat was applied at the end of the month, and voila! 71 trestle vents just waiting for a garden railroad. Unfortunately, they remained stacked in my new shed until 2014. It wasn't until October when I brought the vents out of the shed and put them in my in-law's backyard. DeWitt was kind enough to let me take the space where his fruit and vegetable garden used to grow. The vents were lined up in pairs along the fence. I then began laying out some track to see how it would fit in a 15 foot by 27 foot area. That's 405 square feet for which to build upon. Yay! Once I got the foundation down, I continued building upwards. Piece by piece, I started the ascent to eventually reach 3 feet up from the ground. This was going to take a while as each piece of trestle needed to be custom cut to match the direction of the track. The smallest circumference is a 2-foot radius, which makes a 4-foot diameter circle. Eventually, I had to do some testing with the cars themselves to make sure they could make it around the corners without derailing and falling off. After passing the initial test, I knew I would be in good shape to continue. Enough testing, it was time to speed up the process. Each of the vents had to be positioned and leveled to also follow the direction of the track. So, with more cutting and trimming, the higher levels of my garden railroad were well on their way. It took quite a bit of test fitting as well, since the track was on a 3-degree climb and the corners made for some skewing of the trestle. Every now and then, family visitors would take a look at the progress I was making. It was harder for me to see it, however, since I was focused on 2-foot sections and it seemed to be taking forever. That's okay, I had a goal in mind and I knew I would reach it eventually. as long as I kept leveling, testing, and building. I finally reached the halfway point. This meant only one thing, time for paint. But I'd been forgotten, I do. I'd been married long time ago. Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from, cutting I do? Tell me, Ma, when I go home, the boys won't leave the girls alone. They pull my hair, they stole my comb. Well, that's all right till I go home. She is handsome, she is pretty. She is the belle of Belfast City. She is a parting one, two, three. Pray, won't you tell me who is she? After a quick sand down at the trestles, I painted the base coat of white on all four sides. Painting took a while, which was fine because the white paint had already dried by the time I started painting the first brown coat. Well, after a second brown coat, it was back to the cutting, testing, leveling, and nailing. I reached the 3-foot mark, but somehow it didn't quite seem plausible that I was really halfway done. Yet, I couldn't just stop now, so... Now came the squirrely part. This little guy is neighborhood pet, sort of. This was coming along fine, but I needed to set some of the ground track around the base of the bents to make sure I wasn't going to run into bent placement problems later. Did I mention the need to be clean on the track so I built the railroad? Making it around the corner isn't too bad, except that when I came to one section, it turned out I needed a bent that was taller than the one I had left. Therefore, I had to make one. Good thing I had an extra one, so I put the two together, and voila! Building above the other trestles was a bit of a challenge as I was trying to maintain 9.5 inches of clearance. This took a little engineering and a lot of testing. Or is it the other way around? It was time to nail in some more of the track on the trestles to help keep the shape of the railroad, then a quick test run to make sure everything is running right. When it came to going back under a previously constructed trestle, it was important to have the bents not run into the bases of existing bents. What was originally planned to be another curved section was not quite working out as expected, thus a straight section was to be tested as an alternative. Well, that moved the return track too far away from where it needed to be, back to the original curved area, but with a modification. Yes, I actually had to cut one of the curved tracks shorter to give enough room to clear the bends. It is always a good idea to test your tracks along the way with your longest car to check for curb clearance. In order to do this, the ground tracks needed to be in place. The bends were then adjusted to allow for train passage underneath. Once the curb was set, it was just a matter of time before I could secure the corner. By the way, I used all LGB fixed track. Although flex track may have made it easier to work the track around the bends, cutting the fixed track worked fine. At least the issue I had on the way back downwards worked out, and I could see my progress starting to pay off. DeWitt came out to ask if I was close to finishing. Not quite, but that gave me more encouragement to really get going. I continued to cut more and more of the wooden supports to rest on the elevated bent to match the track curves and straights. Finally, I could start painting again. I'm sure it's obvious by now how much I love to paint. Uh-oh, some of the pieces of wood have started to warp. Time to reinforce them with some steel bands screwed into the edges of the longest pieces. That should take care of it. Yay, the white coat is done and it's time for the brown paint. I'll mix it up a little bit with my handy dandy stirring tool. There we go. First coat almost done. Time for the second coat. Talk about watching paint dry. Before I went too far, I needed to nail down the track in the already positioned and painted sections. Otherwise, the track could shift while I'm building. I didn't want to run the risk of cutting the wood trestles only to find the track curves no longer went along the same arcs. It was a bit tricky setting the layout on its way back down the slope, as the bases of the bents needed to clear the already laid track on the ground level, while still making the appropriate curves and straights on the upper levels. It was also important to test the height of the track to make sure the engines would fit under the overpasses. Adjust. Engine test. Readjust. It took some time to make sure it was correct, as the ground was not level and it was necessary to keep testing to make sure the slope was correct and clearance was also correct. Yep, painting time for this last section. White goes on first, then the brown.
She'll be driving 6 foot horses when she comes. She'll be driving 6 foot horses when she comes.
That was quick. Time to clean some track and work on the ground level of the layout. Piece by piece, clean them all, because I didn't want to have to go back and clean them after the fact. Here comes the fun part. Since the ground was a clay type of mixture of dirt and clay, I actually ended up carving out the edges to hold the track in place. Cleaning the track, of course, along the way. Alright, it's looking pretty good here. I have the grooves in the ground, and the track is actually level, which is always good to run a train on. Working along this stretch was a little difficult because of all the bents that were surrounding me. A quick test of the track proved it to be well connected. The curve at the end needed some cutting adjustments to make it around the bends. Then a couple of points on one bent needed to be trimmed back to allow the Amtrak to make the curve without derailing. I was on a roll and didn't want to stop, even in the rain. The next day was bright and the ground was a little softer. This helped in digging out the path the track was to take. I needed to adjust a few areas that were not quite solid. I did some final testing and leveling with the heavier engine. Once that was done, it was time to finish the last curve headed to the tunnel. Kathy Martin donated a scrap piece of drainage pipe to act as the tunnel. The pipe is 4 feet long, very heavy, and fits perfectly. Once in place, I started a little mountain, then headed home to design the tunnel portals to fit on both openings of the tunnel. I printed out my design, and added the measurements for the pieces I would need. Picked up some extra pieces of wood, and it was off to my backyard to start cutting. Placing the pieces to build the portals. It was just like putting a puzzle together. Time to go back to my in-laws' place and run an extension cord around the house so I could have some electricity to continue my portal project in their backyard. Now I could cut the really big piece of wood and make the second portal. The second one needed a bit more test fitting, as there was some natural mountain that the portal would need to fit into. To allow proper drainage of the pipe during the rainy season, I dug a 5-inch trough just outside of the pipe and filled it with large rocks, then covered it back up with dirt. This should allow the water to seep into the clay ground without pooling around the lower end of the tunnel. That was DeWitt's idea. Now that the portals fit, it was time to paint them. That's right, I had to paint these too. Since I had the paint out already, I decided to also paint the PVC pipe I would be using for my wiring conduits. Waiting for the paint to dry, I had some time to clean and put together more of the track to figure out how it was going to go over the tunnel. With the portals dry, it was their turn to be affixed to both ends of the tunnel. I used 4 screws to fasten the portal to each end of the pipe. But this was done only after I leveled them and drilled holes in inconspicuous places. Before I finished the mountain area, I realized I needed to bury the wires and run electricity to the place I designated for my control tower. So, I got busy running wires. I even pulled out my soldering iron to extend some connections to power the track. Of course, I had to do some test wiring with my controllers. Then started to build what would eventually be my control tower. My thought was to build it out of the extra fence boards so that it would blend into the fence. I had previously designed the basic structure, but now had to cut to fit. The day started to become hotter, and I donned an old t-shirt over my head and kept it in place with a hat to keep the sun's rays from turning my neck red. This was a neat trick suggested to me by DeWitt. The ground needed to be leveled just at the base of this new tower. The partial existing mountain would help keep it in position. However, I couldn't just set the control tower in place and hope it would stay upright, even though it was heavy enough, so I opted to hammer in the rebar to act as structural support beams. Once that was in place, it was time to finish the rest of the control tower by adding the doors to the front of the box I had just made. Riding Cowboy! All put together, time to get the wires into the ground. First, I needed to run an 80-foot extension cord from the only outlet on the outside of the house along the wall and across the pathway to end at the control tower. Then it was dig, dig, dig to get the trenches for the extension cord and the PVC conduits lined up for burial. Checking out the control tower again, I decided I needed a top piece that was just a bit wider to go over the tops of the doors I had added earlier. Ah, that's much better. Now, to get back to the track. I still wasn't quite sure how I was going to get the ends to match up, so I did a little trial and error until it worked. Yay! Now I could continue to bring the rest of the track back down to the ground level. But wait, I wanted to clean up some of the wires from the control tower while it was still on my line. Okay, back to the matters at hand. A little more cutting and fitting. Cutting and fitting. Cutting and fitting. And voila! Of course, I couldn't wait to paint. This time it seemed a bit quicker, but then again, that was just a white undercoat. A quick trim and it was back to the paint bucket with a bit of sanding just to smooth out the edges. I almost forgot I needed to touch up the vent I trimmed earlier. Now to the brown paint. I continued with the control tower shelving, then it was on to the tunnel. My family members had been questioning me as to why the inside of the tunnel was blue, so I fixed that. With that part of the painting out of the way, I could focus on wiring up the switch boxes and the power transformers with the wires I had run up earlier. In case you thought I was done with the wiring, think again. That was only the first part. On to digging the trench for part 2 of the wiring path. This time the wires were to control some more switches and a couple of operating buildings. This water wheel house would fit perfectly between these vents. Time to run the wires. There are as many as the first batch I ran. Just have to drill a hole in the base of the control tower to run my conduit through. Let's connect these and see if anything works. Sure enough, time to add a latch to the doors and then anchor the rebar in place with some metal corners to keep the tower from being accidentally knocked over. A couple of tests with the switch track and a minor adjustment was necessary. That switch works! Now I can work on the inner loop on the ground level. But first, I need to replace the adjustable piece of track with the regular 6-inch piece, along with some track cleaning. The last piece of the wiring gets to be laid into the ground. This piece will power the water wheel house and the last switch in the diagram. The mountain can now be made bigger with some extra dirt from the fence area. Back to the ground track. It's time to hook up the activating track feed, which will allow some special train cars to dump their load with the press of a button. This is the last stretch of track that is actually on the ground. It just needs some cleaning, leveling, and alignment to make it past the wheelhouse and the switch wires. Uh-oh, the water wheel is slightly broken. That's okay, because I can fix it easily enough. Now, back to the higher elevation. I need to add even more dirt to the mountain. Time to continue the trestle work, bringing it over to the top of the mountain. The mountain is still not quite tall enough. That should do it. Now that I know where the upper track will be coming off of the mountain, I can continue the inner curve on the ground level. Just a little more cutting. Have to get the curve right. I'm getting so close now to bringing the two ends of the track together to become one. This last section is the most critical because the curves and straights need to be the correct lengths to make the railroad continuously smooth. Some more testing to make sure the curves are correct. Hooking up the last wires and testing to make sure they work. It won't be long now. The last piece needing to be cut. But of course, what good would it be if the last pieces weren't painted as well? A little nailing of the last painted wood pieces to the beds. A final paint touch-up. This includes the control tower. Final track placement and nailing it down to make sure the electrical connections stay intact. The wheel is rotating the wrong way for the river direction, so I need to rotate the whole house in order for it to be correct. Finally, time for the buildings. And after 11 months, it's complete! All aboard!